G'day, Angie Mahari here. On a really difficult subject, I think, for a lot of people, in regard to borderline personality and what happens to people who end up, and you know, some men, but largely a lot of women, who end up diagnosed with BPD. And then what does that mean for all those defense mechanisms and all kinds of things like that there? Wow. Sexual abuse. I don't think anybody has absolutely accurate stats on this, but women, little girls who are sexually abused, sometimes, you know, little boys are as well, and it creates BPD in little boys, I can't say as often as little girls, but it's not that disparate, it's not that different between the two. So, it is to say that a high percentage, in the 87% of those these stats, again, I don't think any of them are wholly that accurate. They can't be because they can't account for the undiagnosed, etc., etc. So sexual abuse is very real in the lives of more, and I'm not talking about boys and men with BPD right now, so that'll come for another video. But it is more prevalent in the lives of girls who end up being diagnosed with BPD than not. So why is that important to realize and understand? Well, because borderline personality is a trauma response. And that trauma response in such a high percentage, like, well, 80% or more, but not all, of girls, women who go on to be diagnosed with BPD have been sexually abused. So this doesn't factor in or take account for other kinds of assaults or rape in teenage years or adulthood or early adulthood. This is, we're talking child abuse, young children, and we're talking about sexual abuse. So sexual abuse is what you can all imagine sexual abuse to be, but that's not all that sexual abuse is. Because if a parent talks about, in this case, it doesn't matter, mother or father, talks about a girl as she's developing, and especially the father, or if the mother, if for some reason, were to sexualize that, speaking about, describing, and or criticizing or humiliating the young female, then that's sexual abuse as well. So is inappropriate touching, inappropriate sort of, it's hard to describe inappropriate looking, but I think you know what I mean. Like when a parent, often it's a father, you know, in these cases, leers at a young child, like an 8-year-old daughter or whatever. Sexual abuse is not limited to the physical reality of what that is. Males talking about, and males who are very much affected by and very much find the intensity of a borderline woman when you don't know that's who you're, quote, falling in love with, unquote, that intense sexuality at the beginning of everything, right, is hypersexuality. And then you come later to figure out that you're likely with, or you know, you come to know you're with a woman who has borderline personality. And in many cases, that woman is likely to have been sexually abused. Can't say all, but many, many, especially when it's pretty correlated, hypersexuality in women with BPD, pretty correlated to sexual abuse in childhood. Not all women with BPD who have been sexually abused as children will become hypersexual. So I want to make that really clear out there, because that's a fact. And people talk about it like every single borderline is the same, every single woman with BPD is the same. They're all going to, no, fit or don't fit or sort of fit, but the trauma is really what's behind it all. No matter what you want to call it at the end of the day, I don't know what percentage is goes the opposite direction from hypersexual, but there's a significant, I don't know if it's 50-50 or, you know, 70-30, or, you know, 70% being hypersexual, 30% not being, I don't know, right? Who knows? But there is a high number, or there was, don't know, maybe that's changing too, of women with BPD that are hypersexual, as men and many clients for 30 years have been telling me about and reporting. And that's often a big part of why you want to get them back. It's not the only thing for men, but it's a big part of it. But here's what I want men to understand about most, not all, but, you know, women with BPD that are untreated, who have been sexually abused in childhood, who may not have that in their conscious memory right now. It may be still, you know, buried deeply in the subconscious. The hypersexuality that, you know, that you as a man might still be experiencing if you're just new to this, a woman with BPD, or if you, you know, had a relationship with a woman with BPD, or if you're in that on again, off again, and part of it is, you know, that great sex. Let me just put it that way. And I'm not judging or anything, because I have many, many male clients. I've worked with male clients, I have more male clients at any one time than female. I'll always have, and it's still that way. But I have female clients as well. So the point is, when men talk about the intense sex, and that really can become addictive, you know? And I don't mean, I mean with this with all due respect. And I'm only talking about one side of all this. Okay, so the other thing I just wanted to say, though, is what you need to realize and understand, especially when you still want them back and you want them to get into therapy and you want them to heal, recover, or get, well, you want them to get better toward healing and recovery. If a woman with BPD who's been sexually abused in childhood, who may not know that yet consciously, goes to therapy, they will at some point or other find that out. And when they find that out, then there's going to be a whole process that they have to go through to deal with that, cope with that. It's a whole recovery process in and of itself. But what does it mean for men who are, you know, very much enjoy that aspect of a partner in any way, but in with borderline women and this intensity, right, from the get-go, this hypersexuality? Well, when they get treatment, and when they get to the issues that are really causing the hypersexuality, which, yes, is largely pretty much sexual abuse, that will start to change. And then there'll be issues in the bedroom because she may not want sex at all while she's going through this recovery. Or she may be able to have some intimate relations, but she may be very dysregulated around that. She might be very sad. She might cry when you think she should be happy, etc. And so, but here's the number one thing why I'm doing this video, and what I want men to understand about the hypersexuality of the woman that you might be with right now with BPD, or the woman that you were with, or maybe somebody who's your ex, or it's on and off again, and you're trying to get back to, you know, be able to have more of that physical intimacy, etc. I'm not saying that's the only reason. But, you know, men have reported to me largely that that's not the only reason, but that's a very addictive part of the whole experience. And that's understandable. So what happens is when they get into treatment and when they start to really work in treatment over time, then when the memories come forward as they're finding themselves and doing some of this, it's inner child healing, but it starts with a whole different process first with people with BPD and that level of trauma before you get to the inner child work that, like, say, I do with people with codependency. It's a much deeper, and it's like a climb up from the beginning of therapy with somebody with BPD to the inner child work. It doesn't start there like it can with people with codependency. So some of whom may well have been sexually abused in their childhoods as well. So, because it doesn't always mean somebody's going to have BPD. And it's not the only reason why everybody that is diagnosed with BPD has BPD. Because there's 13 to 25%, depending on if you believe the newer stats are more accurate than the older, 13%, it has nothing to do with this, at least not from mom or dad or the family. But I've had clients where they have the good mom and the good dad and the reasonably healthy family, but they might have been sexually abused in a church. They might have been sexually abused by somebody down the street, but it's not within the family. And that's not always the case in the 13% either. But so what men need to understand is this hypersexuality, that isn't the only reason you're with the person, but that is so, you know, part of the fantastic in the beginning. When they get treatment, it's going to change. And the more treatment they pursue, the less hypersexual they're going to be. Now, there is a process of that sexual abuse recovery that means a woman will come out the other side of that and be able to be very, you know, have very healthy amounts, a healthy attitude and healthy intimate relations with a partner. But there's going to be a really rough period in between. It takes everybody their own amount of time. Men should be aware. But like if you're seeing this video now or at some point, you're going to already be kind of done the Googling for you think, like, why is my girlfriend or wife doing whatever they're doing? And then you're going to hit on BPD. And by the time you get to my videos, you're not going to be right new in a relationship, likely. Maybe. The hypersexuality of the borderline woman is not going to stay that way if and when she gets treatment. Successful treatment that will bring up the issues of not only finding self, and then working on inner child healing, which takes place after a much deeper process of finding the lost self, so to speak, the emotionally arrested developed self. But I want you to understand, as I've had so many clients report to me too, what happens in intimate physical relations with women with BPD with a hypersexuality is often there are times in the middle of that where they will age regress. And then a man, you know, a man's like, wow, like, you know, and it has to just stop everything. And because then that person is dissociated to the point where there is age regression and you are kind of then at that point with a child, you know, still with the adult, but, you know, it's awkward. So I don't know if anybody watching this video will have experienced this, but I know many, many of my clients have over the years. And then they just get up and stop and, you know, like they don't know what to do and it freaks them out, understandably. And the point is, so the trauma that is there is driving the hypersexuality. So there can be things like I just mentioned happen. There can be times of being extremely wanting physical relations and times of not, but times of needing it almost like to the point where it's way too much, although maybe for some men, it's never too much. I mean that with all due respect. But where it is really like excessive, then you're going to get very addicted to it because, well, it's pleasurable. But what it represents to the traumatized, wounded, borderline female is, she, you know, she's into it. Okay, she's hypersexual and she doesn't have the memories and her consciousness. But it represents, because I've also had men describe to me how these women can be so fabulous in that way and everything, so hypersexual, but often cold right after or cold in the middle of or some weird thing happens or things you just don't expect. And that a lot of clients of mine have explained to me, too, that they really felt like, you know, the woman wasn't really present with them. So a lot of this is, you know, goes to the heart of the reality of sexual abuse and how it drives in many women with BPD, but not all, this hypersexuality. And so then the dualistic reality of the hypersexuality is that it's playing out in the here and now, and many women with BPD with the hypersexuality don't know. So they're just like, okay, let's do it. Like they're consenting adults at that point and everything, but they don't know what's really driving. But then what they're really experiencing and why they can sometimes seem so distant, or you don't really feel, you feel physically connected, but there isn't emotional intimacy with that because there's still those issues of how people with BPD, until unless a lot of treatment, can't be emotionally intimate, even in the middle of physical intimacy. And also it's like many women will have different sensations come up while they're, you know, in an intimate relational dynamic with a man, and they don't know what it is and etc. But it can change their mood states. It can make them definitely devalue after. It can make them cranky before. So, BPD and female hypersexuality, driven by, caused by, childhood sexual abuse, and not all women with BPD become hypersexual. So I just thought that was something that might be informative to people, to men in particular, and for men to also, if you've never experienced this, to realize that you could. I just can't do a video without a phone going off. I'm sorry. That you could experience something to varying degrees of strange or unexpected or not, quote, normal in physical relations with a hypersexual woman who at that point you likely don't know has BPD or what's going on at all. So what's happening for them is the hypersexuality is meeting all kinds of unconscious needs for them. It's a satiation of a sort, but not really. It's also a re-traumatization often, but that is something that's happening. It, you know, they consent, and it's not like anything that the man is doing to that woman in the here and now. But there's so much more to talk about and unpack this. So I just wanted to say that. I just wanted to clarify. This is another reason why I'm always saying something very important that a lot of people don't seem to want to talk about. Not all people with BPD are the same. Not all women with BPD are the same. In a multitude of ways that go across a multitude of issues that men will experience with women with BPD. And I hope that that was helpful and informative and helps you to understand that, as with everything else with the borderline woman that you're with or you've been with and you didn't know, the hypersexuality is very pleasurable, but it's also symptomology at play. And people can't know that. And I'm not trying to say a man is doing anything wrong when engaging in sexual relations with a woman with BPD who's got hypersexuality, who was sexually abused as a child, might not know that yet, might not be aware of it. There's not anything wrong in that adult consensual space. I'm not saying anything about that. But men need to realize that this hypersexuality is coming out of trauma. So it, like the idealization and the people-pleasing and the mirroring, and or if you want to call it love-bombing, whatever, it isn't really like a narcissist, but whatever. You need to also realize and understand that the hypersexuality and that woman that you fell in love with that you might still want back, and you might want that hypersexuality back, you have to realize that that is a part of her that is being expressed that way, which is, you know, consensual and adult, but that is also coming from another place. And that's likely why so many men report to me that I've had as clients over the years, and I can't say anything about right now, you know, like I have to be very vague, but that there's all these other things that take place around, you know, whether there's going to be, you know, sex today or tonight or many times today or many times in the week, or it starts to trail off, or what's going on and what happens with hypersexuality, with splitting and devaluation, etc. And then the ultimate of what is that woman really going through? And not necessarily is she consciously aware, but she may have different feelings that come up and you may see different presentations. And the other thing is that when women with BPD who have hypersexuality get enough treatment, they won't be hypersexual anymore. So just, I hope that's helpful to some men, and I would love to hear from men if you feel comfortable in talking about your experience with this, where you're at right now. Might you be somebody who's trying to get your ex back, and this is part of it, not all of it, but that you don't realize that, you know, and if they are in treatment, of course, not just DBT therapy, no, has to be a a psychodynamic modality of very deep and very long-term treatment for all of this recovery, and based on the trauma and what produces or causes the hypersexuality in women with BPD, which can be similar to what causes it in the narcissistic woman as well. This is the trauma that is the foundation of what, and other trauma as well, that is really what BPD and NPD, you know, in different ways are. And they're not one and the same thing. Hypersexuality is a symptom of childhood sexual abuse. It's not something that is who this woman is, whether it's a woman with BPD or a woman with NPD. And it's not something that's going to really be maintained throughout the course of a relationship or over years, whether or not they get treatment, but especially when they do get treatment. So, like I said, I hope that was helpful and informative. Take care.